Hi, I'm David Freudberg, host of Humankind, and I love my work, the opportunity to talk with remarkably enlightened people about things that really matter to all of us. And honestly, the most fun I have is when I hear from listeners I've never met, often from places I've never visited, who've been touched by our Humankind program. The grants we get from the funders you hear named on our program simply don't cover all our expenses. And if you like what you hear, we're asking for your help so we can keep the program and this podcast going. Please visit humanmedia.org and at the top of the homepage, click on how you can help. Thanks. Humankind is produced in association with WGBH Boston and supported by the Humankind Program Fund. Additional funding for the series has been provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the National Institutes of Health, the Annie E. Casey Foundation, and the Park Foundation.
He understood, he said, the temptation to violence. And I believe it. And he had to truly come to grips with that temptation and to overcome it.
How Martin Luther King's civil rights movement struggled for ways to meet hate with love. You're listening to Humankind. I'm David Freudberg. Racial discrimination and hatred are sometimes hidden, lurking in a person's heart if not always spoken by their lips. But prejudice was often unashamed and barefaced during the era of Jim Crow segregation in the American South. Posted signs would restrict people of color from access to public facilities. I recently came across a photo depicting that time and showed it to Dr. Vincent Harding, an associate of Martin Luther King, and now emeritus professor at the Iliff School of Theology in Denver.
It's a picture of a young black man, I think at least he's young, but I'm not sure, who is bending over a very broken, dirty-looking water fountain that has the sign colored over it, attached by a pipe extending along the wall to a much more modern, adequate-looking fountain with the word white over it. The scene is from North Carolina in 1950, and it certainly is symbolic of the legally enforced segregation that was present throughout much of the South in the period up to the late 50s. And I would like to see here a man who is saying, one day this will not be, and I will be part of what it takes to change it. That is what I would like to see.
And I have another image here from Birmingham, Alabama, in 1963. Can you describe this photo?
I should say that I was in Birmingham, Alabama at this time and saw these actions of police and, in this case, firemen using fire hoses to attack mostly the young people who were giving leadership to the desegregation campaign that was taking place there in the spring of 1963. I see them frightened. I see them hoping that they will be able, through their sacrifice, to bring about changes that their parents and grandparents could not bring about, but that they hoped for.
High-powered hoses under the direction of Birmingham Sheriff Bull Connor were just one weapon used against demonstrators in the tumultuous civil rights campaigns of the 1950s and 60s. They also faced snarling police dogs, clubs, and the ordeal of being shoved and taunted by insult and epithet. Sometimes fevered mobs would assemble, determined to thwart those seeking racially equal treatment at lunch counters, on buses, and in public schools.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
All the people of the South are in favor of segregation. And Supreme Court or no Supreme Court, we are going to maintain segregated schools down in Dixie.
The late Senator James Eastland of Mississippi, speaking in defiance of the 1954 U.S. Supreme Court decision mandating integrated public education. The court ruled that separate schools for blacks usually meant inferior schools. For African Americans, their children's future was at stake. But throughout much of the South, the machinery of government was arrayed against them, and violent protests would have been readily crushed by authorities. Dorothy Cotton, now living in Ithaca, New York.
We were all studying and learning about nonviolence, but mostly because we were just in the throes of the action, and we had mass meetings every night when, of course, that was the theme, that was, we heard the rationale for doing what we were doing in these mass meetings, and it flowed from, you know, the teachings of Jesus and the teachings of Gandhi and the teachings of, you know, the philosophers and theologians that Martin had studied. And, you know, the sermons were grounded in that teaching.
Somebody must have sense enough to meet hate with love. Somebody must have sense enough to meet physical force with soul force. If we will but try this way, we will be able to change these conditions and yet at the same time win the hearts and souls of those who have kept these conditions alive. A way as old as the insights of Jesus of Nazareth, as modern as the techniques of Mohandas K. Gandhi. That is another way.
I met Martin King originally in 1958 when a black and white group of us from an interracial church in Chicago decided to travel together in a station wagon through the South.
Dr. Vincent Harding.
Trying to express our deep conviction that the five of us, three whites and two blacks, were brothers in faith and would not submit ourselves to the laws of segregation, which we believed were unjust laws and laws that went against our faith. As we traveled through the South, one of the places that we traveled was into Alabama, and we decided that we needed to try at least to see Martin King at that point. He was still living in Montgomery, Alabama. He was recovering from a wound that he had received from a deranged person in New York City while he was on a book signing tour there. Coretta was very, very gracious to us when we appeared at her door saying that we'd like to see Martin. She was glad to see who we were. She went back, he was in bed, told him that there were these five strange people who wanted to see him and talk with him. He also was wonderfully gracious, in bed in his pajamas, told us to come in, and he wanted to learn about what we were doing, wanted to encourage us. Eventually, in 1961, my wife and I went south for that purpose, to try to be servants to the movement and teachers in the movement in any way that we could.
Dorothy Cotton.
I met Dr. King when he came to Petersburg, Virginia, where I was living. He came to make a speech because the minister at my church, Wyatt T. Walker, invited him to come up because we had a little movement going there in Petersburg, Virginia, protesting the fact that black folk could not use the public library.
I just find that astounding.
I know. They had a little cubbyhole down in, if you went in what looked like it might be a delivery door in a lower, off of an alleyway, where black folk were supposed to enter, but we couldn't go upstairs in the main library, and you could ask for something and they'd bring it if they were in a good mood. But anyway, Dr. King came to speak for us.
Martin Luther King Jr. burst onto the national stage in his mid-20s by successfully orchestrating a boycott of segregated public transportation in Montgomery, Alabama. The system had required blacks to sit at the back of the bus, and when it was full, to give up their seats to whites. King had recently come to town as a Baptist minister after completing his doctorate in theology at Boston University. A fellow student was John Cartwright.
When his home, during the period of the Montgomery boycott, when his home was bombed, this was during the 50s, the family dashed to the kitchen and huddle around the kitchen table, and shaking and very fearful, had to face the fundamental question, not only of death, but the fundamental question of what was the content of their faith. And Martin says that at that particular time, he heard the voice of God say to him, "I will be with you. You need not fear." And he felt at that moment something that perhaps he had never felt before. He felt not just an intellectual acceptance of God, not just a kind of doctrinal acceptance of God, but a personal acceptance of God.
Martin King grew up in Atlanta, the son and grandson of preachers. He was widely recognized as brilliant and wrestled with profound questions of philosophy and religion. Reverend King became enthralled with the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi, the Hindu leader whose shrewd tactics of nonviolence ushered in India's emancipation from colonial Britain. King adopted Gandhi's core principle. In a just cause, one had to be willing to endure jail, even physical brutality, but would hold the moral high ground by never responding with violence. Instead, protest would be registered through peaceful non-cooperation with a system that is wrong. To King, Gandhi's quest for justice and his ecumenical, unpretentious life made him a more authentic Christian than some church leaders in the United States. Dorothy Cotton served as education director of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference.
We had to help them see that they were not living up to or into what they were preaching. If a white segregationist preacher, some of our folk were arrested in churches. I don't know if you know that. We were, even on a Brotherhood Sunday, we could get arrested in white churches, though they had just preached a sermon about brotherhood. And they never said, obviously, sisterhood. I guess, so we'd have some new language now. But yes, the white preachers could preach, use that same language. They could quote the teachings of Jesus, but it didn't include us. It's like the Constitution initially didn't include us. But we had to become healers. We had to become the doctors in a sick society and environment. And we had to help them see how wrong they were, but know that we wanted to listen to them. This is why Dr. King could answer these preachers who criticized him and us for being in Birmingham, Alabama, in the now famous letter from a Birmingham jail. If these preachers had a heart, and we assume that everybody does, that they did have a heart, that they could be touched, after they're human beings.
King was, as much as anything else, he was a child of the black church in the South.
Dr. Vincent Harding served as first director of the King Center in Atlanta.
And he was at his best constantly trying to take the person who was called the Lord of the church, Jesus of Nazareth, he was trying to take Jesus and his teaching and his way of life seriously. And in that way of life, central to it was a creative way of dealing with the enemy, of dealing with those who seek to do harm. Jesus taught that while the normal approach to the enemy was to return evil for evil, that he was trying to teach something different, which he understood to be closer to the will of God, and that is to meet the enemy, to meet the evil, without being overcome by the spirit of the enemy or the spirit of the evil, without mirroring the terror of the enemy by responding in the same way. And instead, Jesus was teaching, find a way to change the agenda, to offer another way of bringing about a new situation. When you are treated with evil, find a way to respond with good, to open new possibilities, not to follow in the terror of the old possibilities. And King, as a very creative, as a very deeply spirit-oriented person, when he was at his best, was drawn to this. And this whole way of Jesus's call to an alternative way of life was very important to him.
You're listening to a Humankind special, Meeting Hate with Love. I'm David Freudberg. For more information, visit our website, humanmedia.org. Within a month of King's historic oration at the 1963 March on Washington, where 250,000 gathered peacefully by the reflecting pool at the Lincoln Memorial, he became the youngest person ever to be awarded the Nobel Prize for Peace.
I conclude that this award, which I receive on behalf of that movement, is a profound recognition that nonviolence is the answer to the crucial political and moral questions of our time. The need for man to overcome oppression and violence without resorting to violence and oppression.
Can you explain the dynamics of nonviolent resistance and how it is intended to awaken the conscience of the community as a whole, even of people who may be perpetrating persecution?
First of all, let's look at the goal.
Dorothy Cotton.
The goal in a nonviolent campaign, for example, where there are very clearly, there's massive opposition opponents. The goal is to win the opponents to one's cause. The goal in our case was to win white segregationists to our cause, to help them see the rightness of our cause. And therefore, we had to come to an understanding and hold a respect for those who were dubbed as opponents. And therefore, we had to We had to listen to them. We had to hear their view. So we would send, for example, Andrew Young to go in Birmingham, to go over to the steel mills to talk to the leaders, or downtown to talk to the merchants, to help them understand what we were about, the right, explain the rightness of our cause, help them feel what it is like not to be able to go into a public toilet even, not to be able to use a public library, not to be able to express, you know, this democratic principle of being able to be a part of governing ourselves, to vote, to go and explain it to them and hear them and listen, really listen to their point of view, because, you know, again, we may grow in wisdom if we listen to the opposition, as we also used to say. If we went to talk with such people who were dubbed as the opponents, we couldn't win them. Go back to the goal now. We couldn't win them to our cause if we went over, hey, you know, as someone would say, to cuss them out, as it were. We couldn't win them to our cause if we called them names. And we know that a stirring took place in the hearts of these people who heard a voice like Martin Luther King, who was saying that, you know, if we are wrong, then Jesus Christ is wrong. We're working in the Bible Belt, so that impressed a lot of people who went to church every Sunday. If we're wrong, the Constitution of the United States is wrong. So, you know, with that kind of plea, if you will, and that kind of analysis and analogy, people were touched, people were moved, and we trusted that they would be touched and moved. We felt it in our own hearts.
The civil rights movement progressed gradually, often having to rebound from setbacks dealt in court, in legislatures, and in the form of brutality by terrorists like the Ku Klux Klan. Federal intervention in the South was eventually needed to dismantle Jim Crow segregation. Moral authority for integration was affirmed by the quiet discipline of nonviolence. The day when Montgomery buses were first desegregated, the movement circulated a flyer that read, "If cursed, do not curse back. If pushed, do not push back, but evidence love and goodwill at all times."
Remember what it is that we are struggling for.
Dr. Vincent Harding.
That our goal is not to show the opponent that we can be as angry, as unjust, as violent as he is, but that we have as our goal something else, something more. And as we are moving towards that something more, we're not going to be thrown off the path by saying, oh, we've got to hit them back the way that they hit us. No, we've got to keep on going towards that goal of building a new community. And if in the course of it they try to stop us by violence, by painful blows, what is absolutely important is to keep remembering, what are we here for? We're not here primarily to defend ourselves, to show the other people that they can't do that. What we're here for is to keep moving to build a new society for our children. And we know that the new society has to be a society where people don't simply get back at each other, but are constantly urged onward to create something new.
We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes. We who believe in freedom cannot rest.
As you know, the civil rights movement was indeed a singing movement. We could listen to sermons and speeches in the mass meetings. But everywhere in every gathering, a small or large, there was always singing. For example, if you're talking about nonviolence, Dr. King taught the essence of nonviolence is love. Well, already in the black churches, you know, the people sang in the churches, I love everybody, I love everybody, I love everybody in my heart, I love everybody, I love everybody, I love everybody in my heart. We would sing that because it reinforced the notion of loving everybody, which is what we were being taught about nonviolence. And you can't make me doubt it, another phrase. And then I have a lot of fun when I try to get students sometimes to understand the singing. There was a Bull Connor, you know, in Birmingham, Alabama.
The sheriff.
The so-called Negro movement is a part of the attempted takeover of our country by the lazy, the indolent, the beatniks, the ignorant, and by some misguided religionists and bleeding hearts.
I tried to get people to sing. I even love Bull Connor. And I remember some people working with us said, well, I kind of choked on it when you said I even love Bull Connor. And we were, this was on a little march in Atlanta, Georgia. But I'm trying to reflect on how people were touched. They were touched in many ways. We're working with human beings after all, you know, not stones. But I also remember when a man who used to organize for the Ku Klux Klan came to the Highlander Folk School to one of our workshops, and he just kind of spilled his guts, as they say, telling us how he had his young son with him, who was a young teenager. He apologized, teary-eyed, but this man told us how he changed. We can find many examples of people being touched.
In the case of the movement, training of the mind was very important. Finding new ways of thinking about that vision of a new society, new ways of thinking about these people who didn't know that they were your brothers and your sisters, new ways of your thinking about them, constantly thinking about the prize and what is necessary to get to the prize.
How close are we now to the prize?
I think we answer that question best by getting close to each other. That's a question that is best answered by people whispering very deeply to each other of our hopes and our aspirations and our fears and our sense of vision and possibilities. But as we can come close to each other to let each other know what it is that really deeply cries out inside of us for something more, something new, something that brings us closer to our best selves, that then we discover how close we are.
Although felled by an assassin's bullet on April 4th, 1968, Martin Luther King's message of nonviolence is revisited each year on the U.S. federal holiday in his honor. Listening to Humankind, I'm David Freudberg. Studio recording by Steve Colby. Editorial assistance from Thomas Royal. Special thanks to Andy Lancet, Zohara Simmons, Barney Cole, and Kathy Graham. Also to Rounder Records. Our program is presented by Human Media in association with the Network Incorporated. Program development and support provided by Chart Media.
To purchase a CD copy of this program, please call 1-800-5-LISTEN. That's 1-800-5-L-I-S-T-E-N. Or visit our website, where you can also obtain an audio download of this and our other programs and can hear selected episodes free. You can access free written materials related to this program as well. Our web address is humanmedia.org. That's humanmedia.org. Again, if you'd like to purchase a CD copy of Humankind by phone, please call 1-800-5-LISTEN, and our web address is humanmedia.org.
This segment, part one of Meeting Hate with Love, is Humankind program number 111.
The executive producer is David Freudberg. This is Humankind.
To hear more episodes of Humankind, you can subscribe to our free podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or your preferred podcast player. A new episode each week. The podcast title is Humankind on Public Radio. And if you enjoy this program, be sure to leave us a kind review at iTunes and Stitcher. If you want to support the program, please visit humanmedia.org. And at the top of the homepage, click on How You Can Help. Again, our web address is humanmedia.org. Thanks.
Hi, I'm David Freudberg, host of Humankind. I've been thinking a lot lately about civility. Of course, basic politeness and exercising good manners is essential. But I think civility, real civility, goes deeper. It means to choose our words carefully and thoughtfully in non-hurtful ways. It means to be respectful of how another person sees the world, even when we heartily disagree. And to maintain a sense of humility, because as a wise friend of mine used to say, we could always be wrong. These are lofty goals, which I practice imperfectly, of course. But that's the tone we strive for in these programs. Thank you for listening. Hi, it's David Freudberg from Humankind on Public Radio. Today on the podcast, we honor Arun Gandhi, a truly wonderful man who passed away recently at age 89. The astonishing story you're about to hear reveals something of Arun's deep humanitarianism and his life-changing encounter as a young boy with his famous grandfather, Mahatma Gandhi. You won't want to miss this. Humankind is produced in association with WGBH Boston and supported by the Humankind Program Fund. Additional funding for this series has been provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the National Institutes of Health, the Annie E. Casey Foundation, and the Park Foundation.
Grandfather believed nonviolence is much more than a strategy. Although a lot of scholars today look at nonviolence as a strategy which can be used when convenient and discarded when not, Grandfather came to the conclusion that it's much more than a strategy, it's a way of life. We have to learn to think nonviolently, to behave nonviolently, to create an atmosphere of nonviolence if we want nonviolence to succeed.
Dr. Arun Gandhi recalls remarkable encounters with his grandfather, Mahatma Gandhi. You're listening to Humankind. I'm David Freudberg. In a century that saw brutality on the march, two world wars, the spread of totalitarianism, and the development of nuclear arms, Mohandas K. Gandhi offered an approach so radically different that those who opposed him were often utterly confounded. His peaceful tactics, quiet, prayerful message, and unpretentious manner proved it is possible to change the world without resort to physical weapons.
Here he is at last, the mystery man of India, Mr. Gandhi, dressed as he said he would be, in just his loincloth, even in the chilly climes of Europe. And he's carrying with him his pots and pans, which he declared at the customs. He was trotted around to several receptions.
This newsreel report from 1931 didn't quite know what to make of Gandhi, who was then en route to attend a roundtable conference in London. It had been convened by the King of England and would set in motion a process that eventually emancipated India from British colonial domination. Gandhi was the unelected chief strategist of India's struggle for independence and also the nation's unofficial spiritual leader. He believed there's a higher law than that handed down by ordinary rulers.
I do dimly perceive that whilst everything around me is ever changing, ever dying, there is underlying all that change a living power that is changeless, that holds all together, that creates, dissolves, and recreates. That informing power or spirit is God. I see it as purely benevolent, for I can see that in the midst of death, life persists. In the midst of untruth, truth persists. In the midst of darkness, light persists. Hence I gather that God is life, truth, light. He is love. He is the supreme good.
It was on a railroad journey in South Africa in 1893 that a fateful experience would alter Gandhi's life. He was 23 years old, a recently graduated barrister who had left India to accept a one-year legal job in South Africa. Gandhi had a first-class ticket and was dressed in a starched shirt and proper suit. But under racial laws, as a man of brown skin, he was forbidden from being seated in any car higher than third class. When Gandhi rebelled, the conductor promptly threw him off the train, an event that would spark his lifelong quest for social justice. A half century later, Gandhi's grandson Arun would also encounter prejudice.
Well, the time I grew up in South Africa, that was the late 30s, early 40s. It was a very bad time when prejudices were bad, and especially since the 40s when the nationalist government came into power, they really institutionalized prejudice and hate. And so everybody seemed to be hating each other. And, you know, you could see this in the relationships on the streets with strangers and so on. And so I grew up in that kind of an atmosphere, and it also affected me in the sense that I was beaten up a couple of times by white people and then by black people because they didn't like the color of my skin.
Was it pretty bad?
Pretty bad, yeah, the bloody nose and all that. But there were many other occasions where there were no physical violence, but very insulting attitudes, and you know, and that happened all the time. And all that humiliation, I think, just got to me, and I decided I wanted revenge, eye for an eye revenge. And that's when my parents decided to go to India and give me the opportunity to live with grandfather and hopefully learn something from him.
Arun's grandfather, Mohandas Gandhi, had resettled in India in 1915 after leading nonviolent campaigns in South Africa for racial equality. In India, he would take up the cause of the untouchables, the lowest caste. To identify with the poor, he shed his lawyer's attire, appearing now with a shaved head, a cotton shawl, and sandals. This also allowed Gandhi to practice simplicity, which he thought to be mentally and spiritually virtuous. Gandhi opposed British economic policies that left hundreds of millions of peasants in deep poverty. On many occasions, his peaceful protests would land him in jail. By the mid-1940s, Gandhi was a world figure, living in Sevagram, a village of service he founded in India. There he tried to broker harmony between India's Hindu and Muslim populations, as together they rebelled against Britain. Into this scene arrived his troubled 12-year-old grandson, Arun.
I did feel positive vibes coming from him. Although the last time I had seen him was when I was 6 years old. And I had been told about how great he was and what great things he had been doing by my parents, and I had read about it in newspapers and so on. So I was aware that he was somebody special. I didn't realize how special until I met him and saw the adulation of the people around him. And he had that kind of an aura around him, you know, where you just could not ignore his presence and the positive vibes that he was sending out. Although he is very simple, he is half naked, he is wearing only a little bit of a cloth around his waist, and he's sitting there in the corner of a room on the floor there. But there's something all around him that is very calming and very
calming.
Yeah, very peaceful kind of thing, and you just feel from within that connectedness, that, you know, the spiritual power,
connectedness with you, with all.
Yeah, he had the ability to connect with everybody who came in his presence. And he kind of mesmerized you. And the result was that when he talked to you or when he asked you to do something, even though it was a very difficult thing for you to do, you could not say no to him.
Gandhi was worldly wise and also followed strict spiritual practices. He rose at 3:30 each morning, would spend hours in meditation and prayer, observed a vegetarian diet, and over read wisdom texts drawn from different traditions. His countrymen gave Gandhi the rare title of Mahatma, or Great Soul. When ethnic tensions in India sometimes flared into violence, he would quietly fast, a technique that more than once caused hotheads to cool off in deference to the beloved leader, Dr. Arun Gandhi.
He was a very humble person. In spite of his greatness, he paid equal respect to everybody, wherever, whatever standing in life they came from or whatever questions they had. And, you know, on reflection again, I am amazed at how when he was in the midst of such big crisis, political issues going on and the division of the country and all that, and yet when somebody came to ask him what they should do about a headache or a stomachache and, you know, nature cure treatment, he gave them the same amount of time and serious attention as he would when a politician came with an issue that related to the whole nation.
He treated people with equality.
Treated people with equality, yeah.
Now, treating people with equality was so much at the core of his mission of racial justice and lifting the dispossessed up. Where does the strength in a person come from to be able to treat people, whether of high or low station, with the same respect and with equality?
I think it comes from within. Like he would say, that we have to be very humble, we have to get rid of our ego. It's very often our ego that makes us very aggressive and we think that we are greater than we really are, and so we look down upon other people. He said that we must get rid of that ego and be very humble. And he would even, his lifelong attempt was to bring his ego down into the dust. And he said, you know, just grind it into the dust.
And what's left if a person becomes extremely humble and reduces the egomania?
There is a lot left there. You know, we tend to have a very different understanding of humility and humbleness. We associate it with weakness, and we think that we just allow everybody to walk all over you and not say anything. It's not that at all. It's a very powerful thing. It doesn't mean that you allow people to walk over. It doesn't mean that you accept injustice. It only means that you're not going to do to that person what that person has done to you.
Won't stoop.
Don't stoop to that level. And show that person love instead of brute force and respect. And I think that is very disarming, and it requires a lot more courage to be able to do that.
We're talking with Dr. Arun Gandhi, grandson of Mahatma Gandhi. You're listening to a Humankind special, Meeting Hate with Love. I'm David Freudberg. For more information, check our website, humanmedia.org.
Your grandfather set aside an hour a day for you in one-on-one lessons.
I was with him off and on for a period of about 18 months, and almost all the time that I was there, he spent that 1 hour with me.
Sounds like just an amazing gift.
Indeed. I often feel sad that I wasn't old enough and wise enough to understand what a wonderful period I was going through and what a wonderful gift it was going to be.
Why did he decide to devote so much attention to your own development?
I think partly because I came from that troubled background, and my parents, I think, were a bit concerned about all of this, and so they wanted my grandfather to kind of give me some direction and some understanding. And so grandfather felt, it was his responsibility to do what he could.
And can you recall for us some of the outstanding lessons, some of the messages, some of the examples that he displayed for you?
Well, I think in many ways the first lesson that I learned from him about understanding anger and being able to channel that energy into positive action was a very important lesson. I still think that it's important for everybody to learn, because a lot of the violence that we experience in either in our personal life or in our societal life is generated by anger. We get angry and we lose our minds and control, and we do things and say things that sometimes changes the course of our lives completely. So learning about anger and being able to channel that energy into positive action, I think, is a very important lesson. When he taught me this, he told me that he used the analogy of electricity, and he said, anger is like electricity. It is just as useful and powerful if it's used intelligently, but it can be just as deadly and destructive if we abuse it. So just as we channel electricity intelligently and bring it into our lives and use it for the good of humanity, we must learn to channel anger in the same way, so that we can use that energy for the good of humanity rather than abuse the energy. He asked me to write an anger journal. And he said, every time you become angry about something, don't pour it out on somebody or something. Don't act on in anger, but pour it all out in your journal. But write the journal with the intention of finding a solution, and then commit yourself to finding a solution.
So was that a difficult assignment for a 12 or 13-year-old to record all of your impulses to anger?
It was difficult in the beginning because I didn't know how to do this, but he was very patient and he guided me through this, and he taught me how to write this journal. And then as I began to understand the nuances, it became a simple thing for me to do. And I did this for many years, and it helped me understand my anger and channel it effectively.
Was the power of that simply noticing the extent of your anger?
Noticing the extent, noticing what could have happened if I had acted in anger and retorted and did things. how it could have escalated, but how important it was to find a solution that was mutually understandable and agreeable. Another important lesson that I learned from him was about the depth and the breadth of his philosophy of nonviolence. You know, like many people, I was under the impression that nonviolence is the opposite of violence. That as long as we are not going around beating up people and fighting and indulging in wars and all that, that we are nonviolent people. And he made me realize that we are not. That all of us, however peaceful we may think ourselves to be, that we are all violent and we are committing violence in different ways.
Inwardly violent?
Inwardly violent, passively violent.
Passive-aggressive.
Passive-aggressive violence. And, you know, to make me understand this as a little boy, he made me draw a family tree of violence on the same principles as genealogical tree, with passive violence and physical violence as the two offsprings. And every day I had to analyze all my experiences and put them on that tree. If it was the kind of violence where physical force was used against anybody, it would go under physical violence. But if it was the kind of violence where no physical force was used and yet you hurt people, directly or indirectly, consciously or unconsciously, that would go under passive violence. So that would be things like calling names, teasing, you know, discrimination, oppression, suppression, religious, philosophical, racial, colored prejudice, all of these things that hurt people directly or indirectly would go under passive violence. And when I started doing this and religiously putting it down on that tree, within a few months I was able to fill up a whole wall in my room with acts of passive violence.
That I had been committing.
And that's when I realized how much passive violence there was in society. And then he explained the connection between the two. He said, we commit passive violence all the time, consciously and unconsciously, and that generates anger in the victim, and the victim then resorts to physical violence to get justice. So it is passive violence that fuels the fire of physical violence. So logically, if we want to put out the fire of physical violence, we have to cut off the fuel supply.
And what does it mean to lead a life without passive violence, without the catalysts for physical violence?
Let me put it this way. To practice nonviolence the way Gandhi wanted us to practice it, we have to allow all the positive emotions, positive attitudes to surface and to dominate our thinking. Things like respect, love, compassion, understanding, all of these things that we are capable of, and we show it off and on, at certain times only, but otherwise we suppress it and allow ourselves to be dominated by negative thoughts like hate and prejudice and discrimination and suppression and suspicion of people and exploitation and all of these things that we do every day without even a second thought about it. That has to be suppressed. We have to suppress the negativity and allow the positive things to emerge and display that in our daily life, in our relationships with each other. There has to be that respect and love and understanding and compassion for all of human beings and all of creation.
The life of Mahatma Gandhi was stirringly portrayed in the Academy Award-winning 1982 film entitled Gandhi, starring Ben Kingsley.
Where there's injustice, I've always believed in fighting. The question is, do you fight to change things or do you fight to punish? For myself, I've found we're all such sinners, we should leave punishment to God.
What about for people who feel they've been aggrieved, feel that aggression has been perpetrated against them feel that they've been hurt in relationships, who have trouble letting go of those hurts. How does the Gandhian philosophy apply there?
Well, if we don't let go of that hurt and don't find a solution to it, then we are harming ourselves as much as we are trying to harm the other. Because anger destroys the person, like Gandhi would say, that anger is like acid, that not only has the destructive quality, but it destroys the vessel in which it is contained.
The person who harbors the anger.
Harbors the anger. So, you know, we are destroying our lives when we are obsessed with anger and we want somebody to pay for this, and we are bent on making that person pay for it. We are destroying ourselves in the process there.
Although the world often mourns those who are sacrificed in warfare, both combatants and civilians, advocates of nonviolent conflict resolution are sometimes dismissed as hopeless dreamers. How, it is argued, can peaceful non-cooperation possibly be expected to disarm the likes of mass murderers?
Hitler and bin Laden and all of these people didn't emerge overnight and come to the conclusion that they were going to do all the nasty things that they did. It was brewing over a period of time, and then they became such tyrants. And, you know, we noticed them only when they became tyrants. Until then, we just ignored them.
A failure to prevent a problem before
if we had that culture of nonviolence, we would have seen the conflict before it became a crisis, and we would have done something at that time to scotch the whole thing at that level before people were killed and all the nasty things were done there. But because we don't live in that kind of culture, we ignore all these things as long as it doesn't affect us. And then when it gets out of hand and it becomes like 9/11 or the Holocaust or something, then everybody wakes up and say, hey, what went wrong here? And then you want to crush that movement. And today we succeeded in destroying Hitler. We succeeded in destroying the Nazi army. But we didn't succeed in destroying the hate that they propagated. That Nazi hate is still flourishing all over the world, and it's growing all the time because we ignored that part of it. We just attacked the person and destroyed him. Today we may attack and destroy bin Laden, but the thought and the philosophy that he has given birth to is spreading all over. And we'll never be able to destroy that because we are not concentrating on that at all.
Mahatma Gandhi's long pursuit of Indian independence from Britain was finally realized in August 1947. But the ethnic tensions he worked so hard to ease, principally between Hindus and Muslims, were never fully reconciled. As a result, the country was partitioned, with Pakistan splitting off into a separate nation, a transition that provoked further violence, leaving Gandhi deeply dispirited. A half year later, as Gandhi walked down a garden path to communal afternoon prayers, a young man pulled out a pistol and shot him in the chest. Mahatma Gandhi died that day, January 30th, 1948, at age 78. His grandson, Arun.
It was just 2 months ago that I had left him, and that everything was still fresh in my mind. And I was so shaken by that. I expressed the desire to be there and throttle the person who did this. And that's when both my mother and father reminded me of the lesson that grandfather had taught me. He said he wouldn't like it if you did that kind of thing. We have to forgive that person and move ahead from it. And so they have...
Even at that moment of your mother's grief,
she had that understanding that grandfather had instilled in them, that revenge was not part of nonviolence.
Dr. Arun Gandhi directs the M.K. Gandhi Institute for Nonviolence at the University of Rochester in New York. You're listening to Humankind. I'm David Freudberg. Studio recording by Steve Colby. Editorial assistance from Thomas Royal. Special thanks to Kathy Graham and Andy Lancet. Music from Rasa Music and the CD 1001 Ways. Our program is presented by Human Media in association with The Network Incorporated. Program development and support provided by Chart Media.
You can hear more episodes of our series at humankindpodcast.org. That's humankindpodcast.org.
This segment, part two of Meeting Hate with Love, is Humankind program number 112.
The executive producer is David Freudberg. Please subscribe to our free weekly podcast. The title is Humankind on Public Radio. You can find it at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and all major podcast services, as well as through our website. Again, the podcast title is Humankind on Public Radio. And if you'd like to support our program, please visit humankindpodcast.org, and at the top, click on How You Can Help. Thank you.